Dovuto.
Top.
Start from the beginning because allora today we try to study the dynamic management of the blocks. But it is impractical to start the dynamic management of the whole flow sheet. So, since you are beginner in this kind of analysis, we start with the management of just two blocks. Because we are just learning the basics.
Ok.
Allora, if you want to copy down the data from your flow sheet, okay. Nevertheless, I start from the scratch, also because Francesco has just the blank file. So the components were etilbenzene,
Un attimo che mi si è inchiodato Aspen. Ok, adesso.
no.
No, vabbè, queste copie craccate del
Io
cazzo.
posso dire che comunque il mio Aspen funziona meglio del mio Modern. Eh?
Bene.
Questo lo posso dire.
Non è da tutti.
Allora. Ok, create.
Ah, ma c'è anche la scelta. Chantal.
Ok.
Non mi sentite ancora. Chantal, alla fine sei salita.
Sì, sono riuscita ad arrivare. Potrei avere dei problemi per colpa della neve, quindi perdonatemi.
Zene, Stirene, Ardi Organics. Then we have water. And then we have the gas, etilene. Metano. And hydrogen. Quanti cazzo di idrogeni ha Aspen?
Sai che ho scoperto che se scrivi il nome direttamente sul component ID e ci sta tutto il nome, te lo aggiunge diretto.
Sì, però lo so, ma sai perché non lo faccio tanto spesso? Perché non funziona con tutte le specie chimiche.
Ah, ok, è vero, sì, è vero, effettivamente.
Ok, I don't mind renaming the chemicals because we are never going to change the molar fraction of them. Allora, the selected method was Uniquac RK. Because we saw that it had a little advantage in describing the solubility of this stuff. We need the R components for the gas. Allora.
Sì, vetro.
We need, allora, it exchangers, but this time we use the class itx. The rigorous one.
Ok.
And then we need a flash try block to do the separation. Allora, it's better to use a flash try than a decanter in this case. Allora, hot string in the condenser. Hot string going in the condenser.
Solo che adesso tutti i miei stream sono tornati a sembrare svastiche come al solito.
Beh, li puoi dare.
È un mio messaggio di svarion.
Ok, these were more or less the field. 105 degrees, 2.1 bars. Allora, and we had kilograms per hour. And then these mass fractions. Allora. Etilbenzene, 9.3%. Bene. Riuscite a vederlo il mio schermo? O vedo
sì, a passare?
Oh, they are mass fraction, not mole fractions. And also the flow is in mass, not in mole.
Okay.
Okay, allora, then we have to specify the cooling water for the condenser. Allora, for now, we just put something. Because the first thing will be to find the right quantity. Allora. Boh, non lo so. I start with 1000 cubic meter per hour. Più ruote. Allora, this condenser for now may be specified in shortcut mode with the outlet temperature for the hot stream. That was 40 degrees.
Yes.
Allora, we just select in the block options. For the hot side, allora, we check that the air constant is active. Allora, and then we check for the outside the vapor liquid liquid option.
Okay.
So in this way we account for the mixing enthalpy here in this block and the decanter can be specified as a simple separator. So this okay. means that for the decanter you put pressure, the separation pressure that was more or less 1.2 bar and duty zero. Our key components, water for the second liquid.
Yes.
And in block options, you pay attention to have the Henry constant active.
Run.
Tire.
Madonna, quanti warnings.
Allora, I get a warning that tells me that there is an inconsistency for the feed stream. This is due to the fact that allora, in the condenser there are calculated two liquid phases. While the feed stream is flashed with a single liquid. But I don't mind because this is only a warning. Now, my cooling water is heated by 10 degrees. There is too much for utility. It is better to have a less temperature increase for utility. So at least 1,500 cubic meters per hour.
Proviamo.
Ok. Ci siamo?
Mm-hmm.
Avete tutti più o meno questi risultati?
Aspetta che rimetto un numero accettabile di acqua. Faccio rigirare.
You should try to have the cooling water exiting not hotter than 25-27 degrees. More or less.
Yes.
Okay.
Allora, the decanter should issue 1,000 more or less kilograms per hour of vapors, something like 20,000 kilograms per hour of light fluid, and more or less 60,000 kilograms per hour of water. Allora, we just check that the organics are made by the organic stuff. Okay, water is less than 0.1%. So, there is styrene, tinbenzene, and the residual of other aromatics. So, the separation was accomplished.
Mm-hmm.
Allora, the point is that to describe the dynamic behavior of the system, not the steady state, guys, the dynamic behavior of the system, we need to know the sizes of the block. You get the point.
Mm-hmm.
Cioè, for example, when you want to describe a thermal transient, you need the heat capacity of your system. the heat capacity is related to the mass that you want to heat up on to cool down. Okay. Now, we are about to describe a thermal and mass transient. So, for example, we need to know the inventory of fluids stored in our blocks. Cioè, in other words, if I have a lot of fluid in the block, for example, I will have to wait much time to deplete the blocks, for example. Imagine to stop the feed and leave the exit valves open, you will start to empty your tank. Okay, the time that you have to wait is proportional to the quantity of liquid initially stored.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
The mass flow rate at the steady states tell us nothing of how much liquid is inside. Because virtually, for Aspen Plus, I could maintain any flow rate with any liquid level inside our blocks. I bet that this is clear. Now, how to size two blocks like this? Allora, for the condenser, it is no problem because we will use the heat exchanger design of the Aspen Neck. And so, it is 10 minutes, it is a quarter of an hour, but it is Aspen that will do the job. For the decanter, it's the thing is more complicated because Aspen does not have a plug-in to size a three-phase separator. So, allora, I carried out the job in the past days. I showed you the reference. Allora, this is the first reference that you can use if you want to do such a job. Allora, this paper is very nice, very handy. It has a lot of useful equation. The only issue of this paper is that the method described is for few oil, high quantity of water, and negligible vapor. So, if you do the sizing with this guide, you still have the problem of how to decide the vapor velocity, essentially. Okay, so you need also something for the vapor. Allora, this guide issued by the Petroskills company, it's also a nice tool for the vapor. It is a step-by-step guide on how to size the vapor flow outside this type of decanters. If you put together these two guidelines, you should come up with a more or less correct sizing of your stuff. As a general reference, you can also use this book. Okay. In this book, you find all the correlation that you want virtually. For the two phase or three phase and stuff. If you browse the internet, you find also something already done, ready to use. Pronto?
Yes.
Ok. So, morale della favola. Allora, I found out that with these flow rates, this decanter can be specified with this option. Allora, go inside the decanter block.
Yes.
Ok. Click on the tab Dynamic.
Okay. Enter Dynamic.
Allora, if you find grayed out, click on Dynamic also in the upper menu bar.
Okay.
And then click Dynamic Mode.
Yes.
Allora, you see that the default is instantaneous. This means that there is no delay between what gets in and what gets out. Cioè, your block is a point.
Okay.
Yes.
A point has zero delays. And so it has not a real dynamic behavior. You select horizontal, that is our case. Nevertheless, just to mention, there are also the centrifugal decanters in the world. Okay, mm-hmm. They are more efficient. They can give the same separation degrees in less time. The problem is that they are more expensive because a centrifuge requires an engine to
energy. In.
Okay.
Yes.
So it's more compact, but requires electricity. A normal tank instead is larger, of course, and because it requires a higher residence time, but it does not require any engine. Allora, head type. Allora, I made the calculation with flat heads, so, but this is not a big issue. The length should be something like 6.5 meters and diameter some like 2.2. Allora, what I basically did, guy, is this. I use this guide that is very simple to follow. Okay. And I did the sizing without the vapor. Then I used the sizing that I already had obtained, and I checked that the vapor velocity outside was in range. Because after you read this guide and you do the calculation, they basically tell you that the vapor velocity must be slower than a threshold. So, since in this case, after sizing my decanter with this guideline, I get a slow enough vapor velocity, okay, I closed the Excel file and the sizing was done. So this is more or less the sizing of your decanter with these flow rates. To eliminate this spurious warning, you can try this. Go to the fit, flash options, vapor, liquid, liquid also for the fit.
Adesso mi vedo anche a me gli errori.
If you have this kind of spurious thermodynamic errors. Oh, the procedure is this. We can have a shell and tube.
Okay.
Size interactive. The aim of this run with Aspen is change the design rating is just to get the volume of the blocks. So I leave everything as default. I don't mind. Just one thing, because carbon steel is a too naive assumption. Because carbon steel may go for firefighting water, okay? Otherwise you have too much corrosion problems for anything else. Mm-hmm. At least stainless.
Okay.
Okay, now it's working. Allora, when you all arrive to a design, we can go on. Once you arrive to a sizing, guys, now you have a simple task for children of elementary school, but there is no other way, I assure you. You have just to calculate by hand, knowing the tube numbers and the tube size and the shell size, how much volume is within the tubes, and how much volume is in the shell, discounting the tubes. Ok? Allora, you see that once you click accept design, the calculation mode is switched to simulation. This means that the heat exchanger surface was calculated with the Aspen heat exchanger design array. The heat transfer coefficient was calculated by heat exchanger design rating. Then we have our unit of equipment. Now, the temperature of the hot and cold fluid going outside the heat exchanger will not be fixed as we wish them to be, but will depend on the inlet condition. It is possible that if you let run the simulation now, you can observe very little discrepancies in the outlet temperatures. Not big discrepancy, but you may also have a warning, a possible vibration problem. But if you were a serious problem, you should have an error, not just a warning. So I don't mind it, really. You see, for example, once you get the sizing for the heat exchanger, you click accept sizing on heat exchanger design rating, and you have the result, the sizing result transferred in your block. Now, the cold and hot fluid will exit at the temperature that is calculated automatically from the heat exchanger geometry and from the heat exchange coefficient calculated by Aspen ADR. Now you switch again to dynamic mode.
Yes.
And we fill this tab on the heat exchanger. Allora, is not instantaneous anymore, it's dynamic. Allora, what does this mean? Allora, you see that you have two values to put for the hot side and two values for the cold side. Allora, what does this mean? Allora, this means that Aspen wants to know when the model has to be treated dynamically, if the pressure drop will be calculated at the beginning, at the middle, or at the end. For example, allora, we calculated that the cold side must hold 0.4 cubic meter in total. Voi vedete qualcosa di diverso?
E 0,5 okay, dici la differenza fra shell e tubi?
No, not the difference, the tube e basta. For example, for the cold side I have 0.4 cubic meter of total inventory. If I divide it in two, this means that Aspen will calculate the pressure drop in the middle of the block when I go to dynamic simulation.
Okay.
If I write, for example, 0.3 and 0.1, it will mean that the pressure drop will be calculated at 3/4 of the heat exchanger length. Mm. The basic option is to split your total inventory in two, 50%. So for my sizing, the inventory of the cold side was 0.4 and I split in two. For the hot side, I had 0.58, so I split in two like this. Alessandro, ti passo il file sulla chat di Zoom. Do like this. Close the flow sheet and reopen.
A me ha aperto il flow driver, flow.
Vedi Renato, il tuo Aspen funziona ancora meglio del mio.
Wow.
Dobbiamo chiuderglielo, riaprirlo e fargli fare update flow driver.
No, chi ha mai parlato di update? Chi ha mai parlato di cliccare su update?
Ah, ok.
Gesù santo. È un problema questo che non dovrebbe esserci, perché dovrebbe funzionare a tutti come ha Renato, che tu clicchi flow driven e lui ti salva il file. Se non lo fa, perché è un coglione, chiudi il flow sheet, lo riapri e poi te lo fa.
Ok.
Ok, me lo salvo posto.
Non devi cliccare update, update è un'altra cosa, lascia perdere.
Sì, no, ho fatto il click.
Ok, now, once you have Aspen Dynamics open, delete this connection and these balls. Okay. We're not going to use them today. And when we will use them, we will insert them by hand. Oh. E che cacchio. Allora, ci siete tutti? Then, allora, in theory should be working already. Nevertheless, allora, you see this menu. Due initialization. Ok, run is completed. Ah, it means that Fushi it is initialized. Now, if you put in dynamic mode and you click on the run button, you see that it starts to calculate. You stop the calculation with the pause button when you want, and we see what has happened. Allora, how do we check the results? Go to Tools, New Form. Allora, I want to check, for example, the flow rates. Mm-hmm. Allora, there is a very quick way to plot the flow rates. You double click on a stream, you pick up the flow, F, and you drag and drop on the plot. Allora, these flow rates are in kilomoles per hours. Okay. Since water is much higher than the other two, I suggest that you plot the water flow rate on a different axis. So you click with the right button, properties, axis map, and you put water on the second axis. Allora, the second thing that one may want to check are the temperatures of the heat exchangers.
Ovviamente ce l'ho fatta ad aprire Dynamics.
Vabbè, tu una volta che apri il Dynamics, Simone, ti muovi bene, perché tanto sei già usare Assortion, quindi...
Sì, la grafica vedo che è la stessa.
Il sistema per fare i grafici è lo stesso.
E infatti.
Sì, Absorption e Dynamic sono entrambi figli di Custom Modeler.
Li hanno tenuto.
Cioè, il genitore è Aspen Custom Modeler, che è un programma che è lì nella suite Aspen. Quando uno ne ha bisogno, il prenato se lo tira fuori. I suoi figli sono Aspen Absorption e Aspen Dynamics, che sono degli Aspen Custom Modeler già preimpostati per certe cose piuttosto che per altre. Ok, for example, the temperature of the water exiting the heat exchanger. T out cold. And the temperature of the stream that was cooled. How taught. I want also to check the pressure in the decanter. Allora, hai due reset, hai let it run.
Non hai detto che bisogna cancellare tutte queste robe blu?
Sì, tirale via.
Ok.
Le linee blu e i pallini tirali via.
A me sta continuando a integrare...
se non lo fermi una pausa andrà avanti all'infinito.
Cosa?
Se non lo fermi tu con tutta la stopausa andrà avanti all'infinito.
Ah, ecco, mi pareva.
No, c'è un modo più intelligente per dirgli quando stopparsi, ma siccome adesso interessa soltanto fare delle prove, è più comodo cliccare il tasto pausa quando vi pare, piuttosto che andare a toccare le impostazioni della durata del RAM. Mm. Ok, now, the first thing that I see, guys, is that the temperature of my stream is higher than the 40 degrees of the design, of the initial design. Ok? Allora, this may happen for various reasons. Allora, if you click with the right button on a stream, you do forms, configure, you see the status of the stream. And if it is editable or not. Okay, this is for example the feed. The same for a block. Allora, you see that the overall heat exchanger coefficient in the heat exchanger here is 2.17 kilowatt square meter Kelvin. While in Aspen Plus, it was 2200. So there is a little discrepancy importing the data. Ok? Allora, this may happen in Aspen Dynamics, guys. If you want to correct this discrepancy, allora, you just reset your simulation and you write the right number here. Now you should get the right temperature value. Okay, you see that at the initial time the temperature was 40. Then you get heat. If you get this effect, allora this means simply another thing. This means that the dynamic way of calculating things produce a slightly different result basing on how the process variables are adjusted. Allora, in particular, check the pressure. You see that the pressure is a little bit less of what we have foreseen in Aspen Plus. And this is probably where the discrepancy comes from. So the first thing that one may want to do is to restore the right temperature. Allora, since we have a cold utility, we just increase the flow of hot utility, the of cold utility. Quindi, instead of feeding 1500 cubic meters per hour, we feed more. You resume the simulation. Allora, you see that the cooling water gets out colder. And so, since you have a higher logarithmic mean temperature difference, also your reaction mixture gets outside colder. Pronto?
Mm-hmm. Sì, ci siamo.
Uh-huh. Allora, the particularities of a flow-driven simulation. Allora, the pressure in the decanter can vary. See this? Is not fixed at our initial value. Because in the flow-driven simulation, the flow rate are fixed, not the pressures. But, allora, since we have multiple flow rates, Aspen don't keep them all fixed, only several. Allora, the feed flow rate is fixed. Fixed total. Then if you check the water stream, you see that is free. The organic flow is free. And the vapor flow is fixed. This because in this way Aspen Dynamics can calculate all the flows because the feed is fixed, the vapor is fixed, and the organic and water split according to the thermodynamic model. The point is that the vapor flow cannot be free, otherwise Aspen Dynamic would not know how to adjust the pressure. And in a flow-driven simulation, the pressure is free, is not fixed. Allora, in principle, you can fix also the organic or the water flow, not only the vapor flow. Okay, guys. But it is not a good strategy. For example, I show you. If I go to organic and I fix the flow, then I go to the vapor and I let it free. Allora, it is possible that I get errors. Sì? Allora, why I get error? Because the pressure drop in the decanter depends drastically on the vapor flow and depends very little on the liquid flows. So, if you have a variable pressure and a variable flow in the vapor stream, the program does not manage the calculation. Instead, if you fix the vapor flow, the program manages to fix the pressure and so to solve all the other variables. These are the tricks of a fixed flow simulation. Okay. Now, for example, you can try to get the right temperature of 40 degrees at the exit of the exchanger. The strategy in this case is to increase the flow of coolant. If you find that increasing the flow of water is not enough, you should consider to resize your heat exchanger. Allora, there are differences between Aspen Plus and Aspen Dynamics Resin, because Aspen Dynamics do the calculation in a different way. And this is because sometimes there arise these discrepancies. And also because the pressure is managed differently and probably the latent heat of the feed stream depends also on the pressure. Nevertheless, the flow-driven simulation is not the best way to study these systems. It's useful because it is simpler to implement and let you see something. Allora, we can close this and go back to our Aspen Plus flow sheet. Allora, adesso impostiamo una cosa che poi andiamo avanti domani con chi ha voglia. Mm-hmm. Allora, you see that apart from flow-driven mode, there is also the pressure-driven.
Yes.
Okay, we cannot just enable the pressure driven now because we miss something. If you want to know what you miss to enable the pressure driven, you click on pressure checker and you get a list of what you miss. Allora, the problem Aspen tells you that decanter and vapor should be separated by a valve and also the organic liquid and the water liquid. You cannot have the exit outside the flow sheet directly from the decanter. You have to put a valve in the middle. Okay? Then there is a warning Allora, it is telling you that if you don't put a valve also between the exchanger and the decanter will have a fixed pressure drop on the inlet. But I really don't mind this. So I just add three valves out here. Pressure changer, valve. Allora, to specify the valves, allora, we can start with this simulation. Adiabatic flash for specified outlet pressure. Allora, the vapor goes out at one atmosphere. Allora, in this case, you can also specify vapor only in the valve, because it is easier for Aspen Dynamics to manage a single phase specification. Allora, the organic fluid, guys, was routed to the vacuum distillation columns. So the outlet pressure was 0.5 bar, more or less. The water, I don't remember. It was more or less one bar. Allora, I check if the simulation run with this new phase specification. Okay, allora now the procedure is more or less the same. Allora, you click on pressure driven and hopefully the file will be saved and reopened automatically. If you get only warnings, okay. Okay, the first thing to do for now is to erase the control that Aspen put in automatically.
Yes.
Because for now we won't use them, and tomorrow we will manage them from the scratch. Le signorine sempre zitte? Yeah.
Sto aspettando dopo che mi apra il shutdown, sto tentando di capire che problema ha. E in realtà io, quando siamo passati a Aspen Plus Dynamics, uh-huh, ho un sacco di problemi. Ho provato a utilizzare il tuo file perché non mi salvava il file nonostante ci provassi, e mi diceva che non era in grado di leggerlo. Ho provato ad aprirlo, un disastro. Quindi quella parte in realtà lo
sto... After erasing the automatic controls, we will see them tomorrow. Allora, I do again a plot for the temperatures. A plot for the flow rates. a plot for the pressure. Allora, in the decanter, and maybe also be out hot and be in hot. Allora, guys, here we need another plot with other stuff to control. Allora, I need to check the liquid levels in the decanter. Because now, in a pressure-driven simulation, the flow rates of the fluids are not fixed. And so also the fluid inventory in the tank is variable. Allora, if you double click on the decanter, you see that you have level, that is the total level of the liquid. And liquid interface level, that is practically the height of the water. Allora, I try to see if those flow sheet run.
E nel momento di terminare i processi.
Anche a me l'ha aperto bianco comunque.
Anche quello del...
Ma a me sono...
No, ora sto provando il tuo, Antonio.
Allora, nevertheless, you see what happens.
Dai, io guardo e sistemo dopo.
A qualcuno di voi il file va? Che sia il mio, che sia il vostro?
Ma il tuo si è bloccato, cioè.
Ok, mi rimane solo il vapore che esce. Okay. Allora, what does this drop in the level means? Allora, it means a very simple thing. That when we transfer a valve from Aspen Plus to Aspen Dynamic, Aspen Dynamic has to do some assumption on the valve opening. Allora, if you go back to Aspen Plus, you open a valve. You see that we have specified here roughly with the outlet pressure. We never specified the opening or the flow coefficient or this type or this kind of stuff. If you habilitate this option, calculate valve flow coefficients, and then you put the characteristic of the valve, Aspen Plus calculate how much the valve should be open to get what you want. If you don't do, Aspen Dynamic will try to estimate the valve opening by itself. So what does Aspen Dynamic do by default? Allora, if you right click on a valve and you configure, you see this row position. By default, it is 50%. Then Aspen Dynamic calculates the maximum flow coefficient and then the flow coefficient at 50% opening. What is the point, guys? That when Aspen Dynamic do this default interpolation, a calculated flow coefficient may not be the one that exactly keeps the liquid level steady. Okay. So we have two ways of correcting our simulation in this point. The first way is to rescale the flow coefficient to get a correct steady state behavior. For example, you see that for the water valve, if the liquid level drops, it means that the valve is too much open. So, in principle, you can constrain the valve opening. Otherwise, you let fix the valve opening and you tell Aspen that the maximum flow coefficient and the half flow coefficient are different. For example, instead of 12,000 and 300, I've read here 11,000 and 5,500 here. I rerun the simulation and see what happens with the new numbers. You see that in this case, the liquid level in the tank increases. So this water is too much closed to preserve the steady state. I go back. And I try a slightly different value.
Io li ho editati, ma non la salvo.
Scusa, devi fare reset.
Ho fatto il reset. Boh, non lo so. Provo.
Ok, now the valve is again a little too open. Now, the water valve is more or less in the correct position to assure a steady water flow with a steady feed condition. The organic liquid valve instead is too much open because the organic liquid level decreases. Remember that this is the interface and this is the total. Allora, this trial and error valve adjusting should be done every time you get a pressure-driven simulation in order to work. Because this kind of discrepancy in data transfer from plus to dynamics are very, very, very common, I assure you. The data transfer is not really perfect at once. You see also that we have 44 degrees outside the exchanger instead of 40. Ok, Mumus Der. Ok, more or less I got it. I have more or less steady levels with the new configuration of the valves. So actually now I'm really ready to play. Quindi per chi sia abbastanza ingolosito, ci vediamo domani pomeriggio, perché iniziare adesso i vari lavoretti che volevo farvi vedere è troppo tardi. Cioè finiremo alle 8 di sera. 8. Ok, allora we want to run a pressure driven simulation on the decanter side. If you want to avoid problem with varying feed flow and varying cold utility flow, you have to switch from fixed pressure to fixed flow the inlet stream, but before initializing the simulation. This is the workaround. Okay. You see that now, due to the pressure in the decanter, at constant feed flow, I have a little increasing water flow out of the decanter. Because the levels are slightly increasing. And so there is more pressure upstream the water valve. This is more or less what is happening. Allora, I try to run with a little bit more water to cool the process.
Scusa Antonio, quanto hai messo di acqua?
Ma vai a caso, Fra. È solo per provare a tirare un po' giù la temperatura, ma che poi non è neanche così importante. È solo per vedere se funziona.
Sì.
E soprattutto se funziona cambiandola in corsa. Perché dovrebbe. If you increase the flow of the cooling water, you gain a step in the exit temperature of the cold fluid. The logarithmic mean temperature difference in the condenser increases, and so you get also a downward bend of the hot stream temperature. Allora, from this graph we can see that, nevertheless, if we want to obtain a higher effect, we have to increase the cooling water more than this. Okay, now for example, I want to correct this shift of the decanter levels. Allora, you see that the problem is likely in the water valve because both the liquid levels increase, not only the upper level. The height of the light liquid interface is more or less constant. It's the level of water that is increasing. So probably I should open up a little more the water valve. Allora, the procedure to do it manually is this. Now you see that at once the water level is stabilized and the water flow outside has got a little increase. Riuscite a vederlo anche se questi graph c'erano la dimensione di un francobollo? C'è stato uno step.
Sì.
Mm-hmm.
Allora, the first rise, guys, depends on the rise of the level. Because this increase the hydraulic head upstream the valve, and so an increase of the flow. Because in this simulation I fixed the pressure at the outlet. And so at fixed valve opening, a higher hydraulic head upstream means a higher flow. This is the point. Now, how one can manage automatically this thing? That is the more important thing. Allora, I do a reset. Allora, one need to add a controller. Allora, the standard controller is the PAD-INC in the control palette. PID. In italiano PID. Allora, to realize the connection. Allora, you have to go to the streams and pick up a... I don't remember if it is a connection or control signal. No, I think control signal. Allora. Output. Allora, we want to manage with the water valve the liquid interface level. And in the control logic, the water level is a process variable, is not a set point, okay? Mm-hmm. Because set point is the level that we wish to have. The process variable is the actual level. So in this case, I want to feed the controller the actual level, because the desired value of the level will be hard-coded by us. Then, output signal. Okay, the controller output. And I go on the valve. Now I double-click the control. And I get this window. Okay. Allora, you see that the control is not correctly initialized because it says process variable 1, and this is true, but set point 50. Our set point is not 50, it's 1. Opening is 50, cioè the current opening of the valve. If you click on configure, I have interface problem here. Vabbè.
Uguale da me.
Nevertheless, allora, gain, integral and derivative. What does it mean? Allora, this controller act trying to match the set point and the process values, manipulating the opening of the valve. Allora, anytime the process value and the set point are different, the opening is changed. But how much? It depends on the gain. Gain 1% on percent means that if the process value and the set point have a difference of 1%, the valve opening is changed by 1%. Rigidly, linearly. Allora, this is not the only thing that the controller do, because after calculating the opening based on the gain, it adds other two terms. A term calculated with the integral and a term calculated on the derivative. This means that besides making the difference between the set point and the process, this difference is also integrated over a time of 20 minutes. And after doing this integral, the opening is also manipulated according to this integral. The same with the derivative. The difference between set process, set point and process is differentiated respect to time. And according to the value of the derivatives, the valve is manipulated again. If you integrate for a long time, you have a slow control. If you make the derivative for a short time, you have a quick control. Allora, proviamo ad andare così e vediamo cosa succede.
Initialization failed. Ho sbagliato.
Allora, you see that if I manipulate the valve in manual mode, the opening is fixed, but I can change the opening by this control tab instead of opening the valve form. Okay, for example, I open the valve from here. And I see at once that the level is more or less stabilized, while the flow has a step increased. Okay. Now I can decide to switch on automatic functioning. When I switch on the automatic functioning, the program retains as a set point the last process value. So, for example, if I let it run now, you see that the set point is kept fixed and the valve opening is manipulated, as I told you before. Vi riesce il giochino?
Initialization fail.
No, no, me va.
Meno male. Allora, you see that now, for example, we can change the set point. Allora, if you want to bring the water level, let's say, to 90 centimeters, okay, now the valve is slightly adjusted. Allora, you see, guys, that it's a little bit counterintuitive. In the last minutes, the valve was continuously opened, not closed, despite the process value is below the set point. This is because the control is taking into account the derivative. So I'm still a little below the 90 centimeters. So the valve should be closed. But for the last minutes, the value has kept on increasing. So the derivative is positive. And so the contribute of the derivative on the operative action brings the valve to be closed. Get the point. Yeah, of course. Now, the other controller, guys. Allora, pay attention because we have already used one process variable within the decanter to manipulate the water valve. If we want to avoid big mess, we have not to use the same process variable to manipulate the other controllers. So the second process control for the valve of the light liquid shall not be connected to the interface level, but to the total level. Okay.
come insegnava il buon Cavani.
Ah,
un controllore voi... su un parametro.
Ah, voi a Bologna queste cose ve le insegnavano?
Beh, Cavani è proprio il top.
Cazzo.
Era proprio...
Allora, if you want to start on the safe side, you always switch the control in manual mode and set the valve opening equal to the present value. And the set point, when you are in auto mode, to the present value. But then remain on manual. Allora, this is the safest way to start out.
Salute.
Grazie. Allora, guys, the liquid level in the decanter is gone. To manipulate the vapor valve, we have to use or the pressure or the temperature. Allora, needless to say that we have to use the pressure. Also in this case, if you double click on the control, you see the proposal by Aspen Plus that is not fit to our purpose. Allora, while you are in auto, put the set point equal to the present value of the process variable. Then you switch in manual and you put the valve opening equal to the present value, 50%. If you remain in manual, you are relatively safe. Because in manual mode, the valve will not change position unless you act on it. Mm-hmm. But we already know that 50% is the value for the valve opening that we want. Okay. Now, I add another control because I will also try to manipulate the cooling water flow according to the decanter, to the condenser actual temperature. So, in principle, this operation is done like this. Allora. I have to connect the controller to the temperature of the reaction with stream. And then as an output, I can link to the cold water feed. Because I specified this feed with a fixture, with a fixed flow, not with a fixed pressure. Specify total volume flow. Okay. Sì, vabbè, questo incasinando un po' le frecce. Comunque, Simone, ti devo passare sto file allora?
Se riesci, sì, volentieri.
Allora, also in the case for this control, ok. Allora, while you are in auto, align the set point. While you are in manual, align the process value. That in my case at the beginning was 1600 cubic meter per hour. You can appreciate that now I'm controlling the feed flow. Aspen does not check it as fixed anymore because it's controlled by the controller. Correct also the range. If you find this kind of problems. Okay, now we can start playing with our
Vediamo.
Okay, guys. Allora, maybe I can try at the same time now to adjust the cooling water level and the liquid level in the decanter. Allora, with the controllers, if you want to start safely, manipulate the controllers in manual mode. After you are confident on what is happening in your system, maybe you start to manipulate in automatic mode. This is just a trick from experience. Also, the pressure is a little increasing. If I want to keep the pressure, if I want to keep the pressure from increasing, I have to manipulate the vapor valve. A little opening in the vapor valve. Allora, be careful when you play manually with the valves, guys. Because the sensitiveness is related to the CV of the valve. This valve have all a high CV. Remember, guys, that the pressure outside the decanter are atmospherics. And so there is a very little pressure difference from the inside to the outside. So these valves manage very high flow respect to a little delta P. This means that changing the opening by very little had a big effect on the flows. Keep this in mind. Allora, in theory, you can also manipulate the controller in real time without putting the simulation in pause. Nevertheless, in my opinion, it is better to pause the simulation before manipulating the controls. Okay. Now, I try to keep the level in automatic mode. Both the level. Okay, now I have stabilized the pressure, or less. I have the valves of the liquid flow that are kept, that keeps the level in control automatically. I try to increase again the cooling water flow rate to decrease the condensing temperature. Allora, I don't know in your case, but I can see that the pressure level, the temperature of the reaction mixer in the decanter is slowing decreasing. I don't know in your case. The decrease is very slow, but is detectable.
Si sta calando.
Okay. Now, for example, we can zoom out. Allora, These simulations in Aspen Dynamics are useful for two aims. Allora, the first aim is to get an idea on the sensitivity of the plant values to manipulation of different things. Cioè, for example, I can check what is the control manipulation that has a bigger effect on the process variables, for example. The other thing is to check what happens in case of in case of a variation of some process variable. Allora, to make a practical example. Suppose now that the cooling water is not entering the system at 20 degrees anymore, but at 15 degrees. Ok? Mm-hmm. Allora, in reality, these things don't happen at once. But, for example, a decrease of 5 degrees in the cooling water temperature, it is may happen passing from day to night.
In some cosa quel pozzo?
Sì, no, scusa Fra, se mi permetto, soprattutto quando non è acqua di pozzo, ma quando è acqua raffreddata con torri di raffreddamento o in piscina all'aperto.
Ci sta.
E allora dal giorno alla notte c'è proprio la differenza nella temperatura dell'acqua di servizio. Mm-hmm. Allora, for example, use the form configure of the stream to manipulate a variable in this way. Start again the simulation and see what happens. Allora, you should see a step in the temperatures of the heat exchangers.
Per farlo aprire.
In any case, you see also a sharp decrease in the outflows. Allora, a sharp decrease in the outflow of water. And a less marked decrease in the light liquid flow. Allora, this is why this drop in the temperature inside the decanter has had an effect on the pressure. And the flows depends on the pressure unless the valve opening is manipulated. But the valve remains fixed in position because these valves are manipulated according to the levels. And the levels were constant. So the valves did nothing. And lowering the pressure, also the flows were lowered. If now the levels go down because the flow, if the levels continue to rise because the flow of water decrease, then the valve should come to counteract it in some way. For example, I see that the water valve, in my case, is steadily being reopened. And the water flow is going to be stabilized, even if to a lower value. Oh, the levels are a little bit increasing. Allora, as I said, ok, you can appreciate how things are going. Allora, in reality you won't have such sharp transients for a case like this, because such a variation of the cooling water temperature cannot happen in 30 seconds. It can happen passing from day to night. But in this way, guys, you can appreciate how a variable apparently not correlated to the flow outside has in reality a big effect. 5 degrees less in the temperature here, a little decrease of pressure, and this little decrease of pressure had a big effect on the water flow, because the valve has a very high CVD, and so go on of consequence. Decreasing the flow, the level go up. Allora, let's look at what we see if I increase the gain of the water valve to try to counteract the transient more quickly. Okay, I can do also this in real time. 1.5 as gain. Okay, if I decide that the controller is reacting too slowly, I can also switch to manual and try to restore the water level to 90 centimeters manually. Okay, this is also something that is actually done in the operative control rooms. But you have to be careful, because now that I opened the valve manually, okay, I actually obtained a quick action. Okay, if you think that your process controls are too slow in reacting, you can always increase the gain. Guys, be careful not to increase the gain too much, because a too high gain can produce instabilities. Cioè, è come quando la macchina vi scivola sul bagnato e se voi mettete a fare i controsterzi troppo rapidi, rischiate di trasformare una sbandata in un testa coda. I have the total level in the decanter at 1.3 meters and the interface level at 1 meter. Allora, look, guys, that since I started playing with the plant, I had some oscillation in the water flow. Okay, in the range of, I experience variation of 200 kmol per hour in the water flow. If you remember, in our original flow sheet, the water that goes out of the decanter is reinjected in the reactor as a process steam. So you see that now, in this 1 hour of simulation, I already had a variation in the process steam flow. the test to be compensated in the plant somewhere else. Cioè, vi ricordate come è fatto il flowsheet? Noi adesso abbiamo isolato un pezzettino, ok? Vi ricordate che avevamo stabilito che il riciclo di quest'acqua andava nel reattore come vapore di reazione. Adesso noi stiamo cambiando il flusso di una cosa che deve andare in reattore. Quindi vi ricordate che avevamo messo il make up di acqua che serviva a compensare le perdite? Cioè, voi vi dovete immaginare che da un'altra parte dell'impianto c'è la pompa e la valvola del make up che stanno lavorando in maniera complementare a questa roba qui. Perché nel momento in cui ho avuto questo calo nel mio flusso di acqua, devo aver avuto anche un aumento della portata di make up. Altrimenti nel reattore gli mando meno vapore. Ma quindi la pressione parziale dei reagenti aumenta. Ma quindi aumenta la cinetica. Ma quindi aumenta quello che esce dal reattore. Slow to react. Allora, I increase the gain of the valvula of the organic. Che cazzo ha? Now, the thing that I will try to simulate is a different behavior in the reactor. Allora, non lo so, I suppose that the reactor start to yield a higher concentration of etilbenzene instead of reactor. Ma no, è higher concentration of organics rispetto a water. Allora, for example, what should happen if I have less process steam circulating? So, the mass fraction of the water, let's to say, is decreased by 5% and normalized. Okay, for example, if you decrease the water mass fraction and push then and click normalize and do it a couple of times, you have different mass fraction for the components in your system at a fixed flow. Allora, this may not be the more realistic case, but we are simulated the decanter without the reactor upstream. So we have to make some simplification. Allora, you see that in this case, like Francesco before, I also had some problem with such a sharp change in the boundary condition. Okay, because if you see the simulation log, insomma, nevertheless, luckily, the calculation went on. So, I want to know what happens in the next minutes after such change occurred. Allora, of course, the temperature remains constant because I did nothing to affect the temperature. I had an increase in the vapor flow. An increase in the vapor increased, of course. The organic liquid increased. The total flow of the feed remained unchanged. Allora, counterintuitively, guys, the water flow increased, but why? Because the sharp increase in the vapor flow increased the pressure. Okay? So, another lesson. Less water in the feed, more water out of the decanter because of the effect on the pressure. Can you appreciate cioè questa non è una cosa banale, ragazzi. Cioè immaginate di prendere un operatore di primo pelo e metterlo al sistema e gli chiedete: ma secondo te, se mando meno acqua dal reattore al decanter, l'acqua che esce dal decanter aumenta o diminuisce? Chiunque di primo acchito anch'io risponderebbe diminuisce. E invece, facendo la simulazione, vedete che è l'esatto contrario, per colpa dell'effetto sulla pressione. Perché io ho fatto variare la quantità d'acqua a pari quantità di idrogeno, metano e altri vapori. O meglio, ok, a pari quantità di feed. Quindi meno acqua nel feed, ma stessa quantità di feed totale, vuol dire più vapore. Più vapore vuol dire più pressione, perché il decanter è un aggeggio a volume fisso, più pressione vuol dire più battente sulla valvola, la valvola reagisce al livello, quindi inizialmente rimane in stessa posizione, più acqua, gradino. Dopodiché io adesso ho la valvola dell'acqua che ovviamente si sta lentamente chiudendo. Perché la improvviso aumento del flusso di acqua mi sta facendo cadere il livello e adesso la valvola sta reagendo chiudendosi. Allora, consider also that in this case I also had a step increase in the light liquid flow. If I were simulating dynamically the whole stuff, this would mean a different feed to the distillation column. Cioè, capite l'effetto di queste cose qua? E stiamo semplicemente supponendo di mandare un po' meno vapore al reattore. Mi seguite? Now I want to check what will happen if something goes unexpectedly in the heat exchanger upstream the condenser. Allora, you remember that upstream the condenser I had another process heat exchanger that was meant to reach the more or less the dew point of the feed mixture. Allora, I want to see what happens if the feed temperature changes by some degrees in time. No, I use the trick that Francesco used before, the ramp. So, final value, I increase until 115 in 5 minutes. Okay, and I hope the program doesn't not crash. No, okay. Okay, I already see the increase of temperature in my graph. Okay, the cooling water is not reacting because I am still in manual operation mode for the valve of the cooling water. Okay. I already reached a temperature of 60 degrees outside the condenser. In this case, guys, you can appreciate how is different an actual condenser from a condenser simulated in Aspen Plus with the temperature specification. Ci siete? Sul ragionamento. Mm-hmm. Guardate la temperatura come è schizzata su. Ma è certo, questo nella realtà ha la sua superficie di scambio, punto. Se tu gli metti dentro qualcosa di più caldo. Now, I try to switch in automatic mode with the cooling water flow and see if I can keep the temperature from raising too much. I already understand, guys, that probably I will not be able to keep the temperature out of the decanter. Because remember that I have a limit of 3000 cubic meter per hour on the cooling water. I am already at 2400 and I still have not solved the problem. But maybe, now the temperature outside is slowly decreasing. Okay. So the cooling water flow of 2014 has managed to keep the temperature below a certain level. Allora, if I want to correct the set point, remember when I switch from manual to automatic operation for this controller, the program inherited as set point the last value of the process variable. 60 degrees is a little too high. I want to go back towards 40. Allora, in the meanwhile, I also look at what is happening. Allora, the first thing, guys, that you notice is that the pressure in the decanter has increased. Okay? Because with this increase of temperature in the feed, also the vapor fraction has increased. Unfortunately, there is some bug in the graphic of the flow, but okay, you see in the tabular form that the vapor passed from 118 to 140. So, more vapor, more pressure. And the vapor valve was in manual control. More pressure. Okay. This means more flow of the liquids. Lower level. And of course, the liquid valve has a slightly slow response. Okay. I see that the interface level is 70 centimeters. The total level is 1 meter. I have to counteract not only the effect of temperature acting on the cooling water, but also the effect of pressure. E nella realtà, ragazzi, simulazioni un po' più raffinate di queste sono usate nei corsi di addestramento degli operatori. Ovviamente non fatte con Aspen Dynamics, fatte con programmi diversi e con una filosofia diversa, però cioè, il core dei simulatori è più o meno questo. Cioè, è come se io adesso fossi un operatore durante un corso di aggiornamento e qui ci fosse un simulatore del mio impianto reale. Mm-hmm. E io sono chiamato ad agire su questi controlli in maniera sensata per tenere le cose in range.
Mm. Comunque, reset, ho rimesso la rampa di 5 minuti e ora la portata sta aumentando di acqua.
Con le rampe va tutto.
Però no, ma prima ho fatto esattamente la stessa cosa, avvio e vedo che la portata di acqua crolla senza nessun motivo. Boh. Con un reset funziona.
Allora, my opinion is that if I stabilize the pressure, I can stabilize the levels. One lesson. Allora, I don't know if you can appreciate on my graph because it's very, very tiny. But look, 10 degrees more at the inlet of the condenser and see what has happened to the distillation column, guys. All these flow transient. Okay. It's not easy for the column and the column operator to manage such thing. 10 degrees of temperature variation are not that much. And I'm almost at the limit with the cooling water because I had foreseen a maximum of 3,000 cubic meters per hour. And I still have not reached the old design temperature. So, we have also learned another lesson. This condenser, guys, is not dimensioned to manage an inlet hot stream temperature of 10 degrees more than the target value. Lo ridico in italiano. Questo aggeggio non ha una superficie di scambio sufficientemente ampia per gestire una differenza di temperatura di più 10 rispetto a quello che era stato progettato. Quindi probabilmente uno dei feedback che verrebbe dall'operatore al progettista è: il condensatore lì è troppo, non ha margini rispetto alle condizioni di default. Mi basta un transitorio di 10 gradi e io, neanche pushando l'acqua di raffreddamento al massimo, recupero la temperatura. Per recuperare i livelli nel decanter posso agire sulle pressioni, aggiusterò il flusso delle valvole e anche lì comunque sono già sceso praticamente a 20 centimetri del livello dell'interfaccia senza che le valvole siano ancora riuscite a reagire, nonostante i flussi abbiano smesso di crescere. Cioè, praticamente con 10 gradi in più al condensatore, ragazzi, ho mandato quasi a secco l'acqua nel decanter, fatto un transitorio di merda alla colonna e ancora non sono in bolla. Chiaro? Cioè, non sono cose banali da vedere, Per questo le grandi aziende, quando devono fare un grande impianto, spendono un sacco di soldi nel simulatore e nell'addestramento degli operatori al simulatore. Perché la prima lezione era che il guadagno dei controllori delle valvole del liquido era troppo basso, dovevano agire più velocemente. Adesso ho anche capito che questo condensatore non ha una sufficiente superficie di scambio rispetto ai transitori del progetto. Mm-hmm. Allora, provo a vedere se Babbo Natale mi fa andare a posto le condizioni upstream, se magari il processo non ritorna in linea. Allora. Ramp. Allora, ritorno a 105 in 5 minuti.
Crollato il feed.
Scusa?
Non riesco a capire. Crollato a picco il feed.
No, questo è uno spike del cazzo. Okay. Non, cioè, guarda. Perché il feed, la porta del feed è fissa.
Ah, ok.
Però è chiaro che lui un attimino sbarella queste cose. Beh, d'altronde comunque.
Sì, 10 gradi in più, andiamo in Aspen Plus e gli mettiamo 10 gradi in più.
No, non riesco a capire se... No, non mi ha preso la rampa. Ok. Ok. Now I'm ramping the temperature towards the old value. I can repristinate the set point of 40 degrees. See that the cooling water decreases because the derivative part of the controller is more important now than the fact that the process value is higher than the set point. Okay. Look the pressure. The pressure is already at its default value. So I switch on automatic mode, also the valve of the vapor. Allora, unfortunately, the bad thing is that the control structure or the control action was not quick enough to prevent the decanter to be empty, because see, I have 7 millimeters of water left in the decanter. Okay. We had a decanter of 6 meters per 2. Obviously, to reach 7 millimeters, it means to have failed the training session if you were in training. Otherwise, it means that you have ruined the decanter. If you were operating the plant, you get what I mean. Mm-hmm. Another lesson that one could learn from this case is that never forget the vapor valve in manual actuation and never let the pressure increase in this way. Otherwise, a big mess. Because from the point of view of the counter level, I could have counteracted effectively the temperature rise if the vapor valve had acted quickly. Look also at the water outside the counter. In this case, the process steam surely experienced an increase. If you want to check what would happen with more steam in your field, for example, we can also keep the fractions and increase the flow from, let's say, 81,000 kilograms per hour to 83,000 kilograms per hour. Let's see what happens. Allora, I have more water, more gas, and more light liquid, all the same. Allora, if we try to increase the flow rate of the feed, of course I have to increase the cooling water. Vabbè. The water, the level is in the counter were low enough that from the decanter side, things are still recovering from the former transient. Beh, comunque quando l'integratore funziona e uno si può divertire, come diceva prima Chantal, a baloccarsi con i transitori, non è male, ci si diverte anche un po', relativamente. Allora, increasing the feed, I had more vapor. A little more water and a little more light liquid. You see that if the pressure in the decanter is stable, more or less I have no level problems. I still have to recover the set points. Allora, pay attention. Allora, I don't know if you have the simulation as I have it. Allora, now I start into increasing to experiencing a problem that in reality I would not have. Allora, I don't know if you can appreciate this fact. Allora, look at the set points of the levels. The interface level is still lower than the set point. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this means that the water valve will not do anything and we leave the water flow as it is. So since the water flow is already low enough to let the level increase, the water valve will not do anything. Now, the total level is already higher than the set point. 1 and 19 against 1 and 14. So the light liquid valve has started opening and increasing the light liquid flow. Okay? So I am increasing the light liquid flow despite the interface level, and so the total liquid inventory in the decanter is below the set point. Allora, in reality, this thing would not happen or would not happen exactly in this way. Because in reality, the organic flow that exits from the decanter is withdrawn from a different section of the section where the heavy liquid is withdrawn. Cioè, il liquido pesante viene tolto più o meno a metà serbatoio, ma il liquido leggero, prima di entrare nel tubo di uscita, deve superare uno stramazzo. Ci siete?
Ok.
Quindi le cose non andrebbero esattamente così. Questa è una semplificazione di Aspen Dynamics, perché Aspen Dynamics non sa come avete organizzato veramente le cose meccanicamente nel vostro decanter. Questo però significa che voi non avreste soltanto due controllori di livello, ne avreste almeno tre, perché vi servirebbe un controllore di livello in più anche per la zona del decanter delimitata dallo stramazzo. Non so se siete riusciti a seguire il ragionamento. Cioè, è una finezza che qui sul grafico la dovete beccare da questo cazzillo qui e dall'osservazione dei set point. Questo è un limite del vostro modello di simulazione. Pronto? Siete tutti troppo, troppo stesi.
Sono le 5 ormai.
Sì, no, vabbè, per carità, quando avete sbaglio, quando volete smettere di giocare, questa è una cosa molto tecnica, però anche extracurricolare. L'avevo detto fin dall'inizio. I miei livelli, ad esempio, stanno continuando a salire perché la valvola sul light liquid è un po' lenta. Lei sta continuando ad aprire, ma finché il livello di interfaccia non è al set point e quindi l'acqua non smette di crescere. Quindi, morale della favola, be quick on the vapor valve to counteract the pressure surges. Design the condenser over-specified with the exchange surface to counteract the temperature transients, and be careful when you design the velocity of the liquid level valve. Otherwise, the column downstream will suffer. And never put on this kind of system untrained operators.